It's nice to hear you in such great spirits this morning. Welcome to the third lecture of our Music Department Lecture Series. We're very honored today to have with us Professor Steven Stucky from Cornell University, who's a composer and an author of major monographs in 20th century music. I'd like to remind you one more time that if you have friends that missed the lecture, it will be videotaped so that you can check it out at the Listening Resource Center. And I would also remind you, too, that we have the final lecture of this season coming up December 1st, when we'll have Eric Graff from the Utah Symphony perform and lecture to us. This time, we'll have Professor David Sargent give an invocation, and then Steven Jones will make a formal introduction.
God has given us, and we're particularly grateful for the opportunity to hear from Steven Stucky, who's taken time from his schedule to come and be with us today. We ask you to bless him while delivering his message, that he will be able to give us those ideas and the information that he's brought with us in a way that would be pleasing unto us and him as well. And we ask you to bless him when he departs to go back home, that thy spirit will be with him to protect him, that he will arrive in peace and safety. Again, we're grateful for the opportunity to hear from people such as this to find out what is going on around us and in the very important world that we live in. We're grateful for music and for the many benefits it has and provides for us. We ask thee now to let thy spirit be with us in this meeting. We humbly pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I noticed I didn't get any whistles. It makes me feel a lot better. It's a real pleasure to introduce Dr. Steven Stucky. Mr. Stucky is recognized certainly as one of the leading composers of his generation. He was born in 1949 in Kansas and is currently a professor of music at Cornell University in Ithaca, New York. He has also, for the last 4 years, been composer in residence with the Los Angeles Philharmonic and is currently serving as their new music advisor. Mr. Stucky is someone who is particularly at home in writing for the orchestra and has had works performed, among others, by the orchestras of St. Louis, Baltimore, San Francisco, Chicago, Richmond, Detroit, Syracuse, Denver, Boston, Dallas, Omaha, Cincinnati, San Antonio, Atlanta, Seoul, Korea, Albany, Virginia, and Columbus, Ohio. And I know that is the short list. He's worked with such noted conductors as Leonard Slack and Andre Previn, David Zinman, Esa-Pekka Salonen, and others. He's received grants and fellowships from the National Endowment for the Arts, the Guggenheim Foundation, the American Council of Learned Societies, and ASCAP, the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers. And in 1989, his concerto for orchestra was named one of the two finalists for the Pulitzer Prize in Music. Not only is Mr. Stucky a composer, he is a conductor and a fine author. His book, Ludoslavsky and His Music, is widely recognized as an authoritative source on the music of Witold Ludoslavsky, one of the great Polish composers of our day. Beyond all these wonderful accomplishments, it's been our experience, as those who have been with him the last 2 days, to note that he's a fine person as well. And what a refreshing and pleasurable thing that is. I find that he's a man of integrity and charity, and it's a great honor to have him with us. Would you please welcome Mr. Stevenson?
I'm tall, but he's taller. I have to adjust.
As Steve Jones said, I'm an orchestral composer. I think I've always thought of myself as attached to the orchestra. I grew up in the orchestra from a vantage point far back in the viola section, a little school and town and civic orchestras in West Texas where I grew up. That's where I learned my Haydn and Beethoven and Schubert and Stravinsky from the inside, bar by bar, from the back of the viola section. I think it's the best way to learn the repertory, from the inside, and it's what I suggest to student composers whenever they'll listen to me. Pretty quickly it became clear that I was not going to be a professional performer. I didn't have any talent, and I never practiced. But I still think fondly of those violist composers like Beethoven and Dvorak and Hindemith and John Harbison, just to name a few. And I still think of myself in my heart of hearts as a string player. I would still rather hang out with orchestral musicians than with anybody else. So when I think about the state of, and singers, sorry, I was there. Lively crowd. So when I think about the state of concert music here at the end of the 20th century, I do so from the vantage point of the orchestra. I admit it's a limited viewpoint, but it's the one that I know best, and I can use it as a sample to talk more broadly about where we are and where we might be headed, to try to get a reading on the health of our musical culture and how you and I, as composers, performers, teachers, listeners, scholars, administrators, how you and I all fit into that culture and how we ought to be shaping it. The picture is certainly mixed. On the one hand, you see orchestras all over the country collapsing, in San Diego, in Denver, in New Orleans, in Syracuse, and if they come back from the dead at all, doing so in greatly reduced form as chamber orchestras and or by playing mostly pops concerts. You see great orchestras like the Cincinnati Symphony and the Milwaukee Symphony, both with honorable records of playing new music, especially American composers, now letting their composers in residence go because subscribers have been complaining about the modern music on their programs, and playing more pops programs than classical ones to stay in business. Even where orchestras are still functioning well, their audiences are getting smaller and grayer by the year. And it is not hard to imagine the day a few years from now when all of the remaining symphony scribers will reside 6 feet underground. I suppose we should not be surprised by this trend because, frankly, the symphony orchestra is an expensive and elitist institution designed essentially to play the music of dead white male European composers. A music that represents a 19th century social structure and a way of thinking that have become distant or alien to most of our society. And this expensive elitist institution is set in an American culture that defines success according to profit margin, a culture that deeply distrusts anything that smacks of the intellectual. I think we buy fewer books of poetry per capita probably than any first world country in the world. A culture that has decided that by and large in most places its school systems cannot afford to teach its children to make music or to listen to music. So when you put it that way, it seems something of a miracle that orchestras still exist at all. At the same time, there are contradictory glimmers of hope, especially from the composer's point of view. For one thing, the playing of American orchestras today is on the whole the best in the world. And to take a particularly illustrious example, the Cleveland Orchestra, I would say, probably is playing at the moment as well as any orchestra has ever played anywhere. For another thing, a couple of weeks ago, as an example, I picked up at random the Sunday New York Times Arts and Leisure section and looked at the concerts advertised there. There were 8 symphonic concerts advertised for New York City in that week by North American orchestras. Not all New York orchestras, but North American orchestras. And together their programs contained 25 compositions. Of these 25 pieces, 9 of them, or about 40%, were by living composers, mostly Americans. And if you add works written by composers who were quite recently living, John Cage, for example, or Olivier Messiaen, who died within the last year, 60% of the symphonic repertory that week in that city was by living or almost living composers. I'm not sure you would get exactly the same results in Nashville or Tulsa or Missoula or Seattle or Salt Lake, for that matter. But in almost every city, The amount of modern music on the programs is measurably higher than it was 20 or even 10 years ago. Part of this improvement came by way of the 10-year orchestra residencies program, which was funded from 1982 to 92 by the Rockefeller Foundation and others, and run by an organization called Meet the Composer. This is the same program that put me in Los Angeles for the past 4 years as composer in residence. So I've seen something of how it operated and the effect it had both on individual composers and on the big institutions on which they depend for their livelihood. Putting an advocate inside the institution, an advocate for the future of music, not the past, a kind of mole in the organization, had a profound psychological effect. And in almost every city in which it was tried, that effect was overwhelmingly to the good. For composers all over this country, too, it meant that suddenly they had somebody to speak for them inside the establishment, somebody who understood them, who they could talk to, who would actually listen to their tapes and look at their scores when they were sent in, and who would fight for them against the conservative, timid, entrenched attitudes of the powers that be. For all those thousands of composers in this country still waiting in frustration for their first performance by a major orchestra, this program was cold comfort. But there are many hundreds of American composers for whom the residencies gave them their first break, whether through a reading session or a performance or a commission. I'd like to tell a story from my own life. I'm embarrassed it's about me, but it's a story I know by heart, so that it comes in handy. To show how the system actually can work gradually, but very well. I took my first teaching job when I was 28 years old. It was at Lawrence University in Appleton, Wisconsin. It was a temporary position. I was replacing somebody on sabbatical leave, and I had no long-term prospects anywhere. No one was playing my music. I had no recordings, no publisher. And I was at that point at which composers usually consider getting a real job, you know, learning a trade. Still, while I was at Lawrence, I commissioned myself, so to speak, to write a piece for the college orchestra, and I forced it on the local conductor, who gritted his teeth and put it on a program. He wouldn't learn it. He made me conduct it, but he did play the piece. 2 years later, this orchestra residency program was announced nationally, and I sent the score of that Lawrence University piece and a tape of that scruffy college performance to the newly appointed joint composers in residence at the Minnesota Orchestra. They were Libby Larson and Stephen Paulus. I didn't know them. I don't suppose they'd ever heard of me. Somehow, though, my score ended up in a pile of things to be read and taped by the orchestra using a grant from a local foundation. So I flew out to Minnesota for the readings. The orchestra seemed to like my piece. 3 years later, in 1985, the Minnesota Orchestra suddenly needed a young American composer to do a last-minute commission for a summer festival, and because the readings were still fresh in their mind, they called me. Probably because they knew I was desperate and would take it at the last minute for a small fee. After they played the piece I wrote for them, it's a piece called Dream Waltzes, I sent a tape of that to John Harbison, who was then composer in residence of the Los Angeles Philharmonic. He gave it to Andre Previn. Previn liked the piece and played it in the fall of 87 in Los Angeles. A few months later, when Harbison's term in Los Angeles expired, I apparently was the only young American composer whose name Mr. Previn could remember because he'd just played my piece. And so there, out of the blue, was Andre Previn on the phone saying, would you like to succeed John Harbison at the Los Angeles Philharmonic? And I said, yes. Now, it's instructive, I think, for young composers to follow this chain of events. It took 9 years from my commissioning myself to write this piece and forcing it down someone's throat by a chain of associations to, you know, producing a position where I was actually going to be paid to be a composer. It required three different strangers, Paulus, Larson, and Harbison, to go to bat for me at two different orchestras in different cities. But it proves two things. First, that a composer needs patience enough and enough faith in his own music to believe that it will speak for itself if you just send it out there. And that with a little luck, this process can work, that this advocacy structure can really make a difference. When I was a student, we didn't write for the orchestra. We were told not to, for good reason. There were two reasons. for this sort of circularly intertwined reasons. Number one, we were all being taught to write in a high modernist style, which, especially rhythmically, is not suited to orchestral playing very well, and especially not to American orchestras' rehearsal schedules. And number two, we knew that no orchestra was going to play our stuff anyway, because see number one. How different a world we live in today, where in one Sunday New York Times, orchestra pieces by nine living composers are being advertised, a world where more and better paying commissions are being given to composers, thanks in no small part to the Barlow Endowment, as you all know, than at any time since the old patronage system of the Catholic Church and European royalty broke down. A world where the number of fantastically skillful orchestral composers is much higher, probably, than at any time in history. Among Americans, in the generation over 50, I could name Jacob Druckmann, Bernard Rands, Ellen Zwillich, Joan Tower, Donald Erb, John Corigliano, who will soon, January be in Salt Lake, I think, John Harbison. Among the middle generation, sort of my age, Christopher Rouse, Fred Lairdahl, John Adams, Shulamit Ron, Stephen Hartke, Joseph Schwantner, Roberto Sierra, Dan Welcher, Stephen Albert, Donald Crockett, to name a few. And among the dismayingly young, already breathing down our necks generation, names like David Soley, Augusta Reed Thomas, David Zube, Michael Doherty, Edward Knight, Andrew Wagoner, Cindy Cox, Mark McGurdy, Bright Sheng, George Tsontakis, Aaron J. Kernis. I selected this list out of a much longer possible list because all of these composers write very brilliantly for the orchestra. This is a situation no one could have imagined 20 years ago. So we appear simultaneously to be living in the golden age of the symphony orchestra and in the decline and fall of musical culture as we know it. Which is it? I would say it is both. I would say that in the next few years, the actions and attitudes of the people in this room, of you and me, and of people like us all over the country, are going to determine which of these contradictory trends is going to win out, whether we seize the hopeful signs and perpetuate a golden age, or we continue to let it slip away, until within our lifetimes, orchestras, opera companies, classical recordings, classical radio stations, and music education for young children all will have disappeared. Both courses are possible, I think. Now, it would be presumptuous of me to offer you advice about how to live your lives. Nevertheless, I'll do it. Comfortable in the knowledge that in 25 minutes, you can go out of here and forget you ever even saw me. So I can't do very much damage, I think. To teachers like myself and administrators, some of whom are here, I think, my advice, and this is advice to myself, which you are privileged or condemned to overhear and welcome to forget, but my advice to myself as a teacher is, remember that the single most important musical influence we can have on our students is not on their parallel fifths in voice leading exercises, or their breath support, or their three octave scales in parallel thirds and sixths. It is on their broad musical culture and their love of the literature. More important than whether they go out into the world to perform or compose or teach is that they will go out and sit on the boards of corporations and foundations and orchestras and ballet companies and museums, that they will go out and run for school board member or state legislature or president. We must teach them to know and love the music of seven centuries, including this one which is nearly over, because when they love it, they'll be compelled to share that love with others. So arpeggios, set theory, composers' dates of birth, Schenker graphs, opus numbers, invertible counterpoint, count for very little compared to this simple central mission, knowing and loving the repertoire. But do your homework anyway, please. Now, it's a small minority in this room who are composers, but I have some detailed advice I like to give young composers, and I'd like for you all to overhear it and see if it's of any interest to you or entertainment. To composers, I have the following advice. Number one, don't be one unless you absolutely have to. Otherwise, you won't have the ambition, the obsession, the stamina that it takes to toil away in obscurity doing what's required to write good music. It's not an easy profession, and even at the very top of it, they tell me, there's no glamour. So unless the music is really its own reward, you know, get a real job. Number two, don't be a composer unless you have a very thick skin and a strong self-sufficient character. Because even in the best of circumstances, only a tiny percentage of the population will ever care about what you're doing, and the rest will ignore you entirely or wish you and your kind would disappear. If J.S. Bach were to walk down the street in Provo, 98% of the people he met wouldn't know or care who he is, wouldn't cross the street to shake his hand or ask for his autograph. I'm not J.S. Bach, and you probably aren't either. The odds are even worse for us. Don't go into composing unless you can take a lot of rejection. Number three, be the most interesting, curious, well-read, cultivated person you can possibly be. Don't fall for the ridiculous myth that the great composers of past centuries were simple-minded peasants through whom somehow inspiration poured. The village idiot theory of musical composition. We used to be told, for example, that Beethoven was not very intelligent. In fact, Beethoven was well-read and was deeply interested in philosophical problems and followed the discussions of ethics and aesthetics in his own time. Mozart, often depicted as a childish dolt who just somehow happened to be the greatest composer who ever lived, was in fact a sophisticated world traveler who spoke several languages, including a little English, and who belonged in Vienna to the Freemasons, who in the 18th century were a highly intellectual and progressive organization. Brahms could quote the poetry of Tennyson by heart. In our day, Elliot Carter knows John Ashbery's poetry by heart and actually appears to understand it. And Ligeti understands chaos theory and fractal geometry. My point is that you can't write interesting music unless you're an interesting person. It doesn't somehow work to focus only on the notes. Go out and be the best read, most curious, most interesting, best rounded person you can be if you want to be a composer. And a related point, number four, get all the technique you can possibly get. Of course music is above all a vehicle for the expression of hopes and fears and emotions and ideals. The question is how to achieve that kind of expression. Wishing doesn't make it so. Only technique can allow you to express yourself effectively. So do counterpoint, learn the 12-tone system, study orchestration in as much detail as you possibly can, and learn the repertoire. If the barber adagio for strings sends you, well, go analyze it to find out why. It's a very carefully and skillfully written piece of counterpoint. If you love the slow movement of the Rachmaninoff Second Symphony, well, go look at the part writing in the strings under that dreamy clarinet solo to see what really makes it work. Fantastically skillful. Don't fall for the popular notion that music is either heartfelt or cerebral. If you want to transmit the heartfelt part, you have to engage the cerebrum to make it happen. Get all the technique you can. Number five, don't go into it for the money. I like what Mel Powell, the great American composer and former jazz pianist, tells young composers. I'll have to paraphrase this. So you want to be a composer? You want to join the fraternity of the greatest human spirits who ever lived? You want to be a colleague of Bach and Mozart and Brahms and Schoenberg? All this, and you also want to drive a Mercedes? It's too much. Number six, don't confuse the aims of popular culture with the aims of art. There's a whole generation of American composers out there born in the 1950s and 60s and raised on TV, rock and roll, and fast food, who have fallen for the idea that the way to revitalize concert music is to enrich it with pop culture, to make it relevant to their own lives in this time and in this place. To quote Jerry Lee Lewis in a symphony, for example, or to write variations on the theme from The Twilight Zone, or to write a piece about Jimi Hendrix for amplified tuba and ensemble. These are real examples by three of our most gifted and successful young American composers, respectively Aaron J. Kernis, Michael Dougherty, and David Lang. Yes, those are ways to energize our musical culture. I've been saying for years that to expect us in our country and in our time to write music that expresses the existential angst of pre-World War I Vienna is just crazy. Of course, course our music must belong to our time and place, but there's a danger in confusing your aims. Popular music is meant to entertain. Art, music and other kinds, is meant to entertain and to edify, teach, challenge, disturb, uplift. Don't forget the job description. Aim high. And finally, number 7, write the music you want to hear when you go to a concert. Not the music you think your teacher expects you to write, not the music you think your local conductor might go for, not the music that looks complicated enough on the page that it might win a prize from a jury somewhere, not the music you think a publisher will want to publish. If art isn't genuine, if it doesn't come from someplace very deep down here, then it won't work, or at least it won't fool people for very long. That's the end of my sermon, almost. I have one more bit of preaching to do, because I'd like to read you a passage that I've depended on for years. I have to ask myself, and you must too, we live in a world where there are epidemics of homelessness and AIDS, and where people are starving to death right now in Ethiopia and Somalia. People don't have health insurance, don't have jobs. Should we be spending our energies on composing string quartets and saxophone concertos and operas, ballets? And should we, I mean, is it morally right to spend one penny on symphony orchestras or on ballet companies when all these human needs are crying out around us? For my answer, I depend on the British composer Sir Michael Tippett. Almost 40 years ago, in an essay entitled Too Many Choices, Michael Tippett wrote this: "Whether society has felt music valuable or needful, I've gone on writing because I must. And I know that my true function within a society that embraces all of us is to continue an age-old tradition fundamental to our civilization, which goes back into prehistory and will go forward into the unknown future. This tradition is to create images from the depths of the imagination and to give them form, whether visual, intellectual, or musical. For it is only through images that the inner world communicates at all, images of the past, shapes of the future. Images of vigor for a decadent period, images of calm for one too violent, images of reconciliation for worlds torn by division. And in an age of mediocrity and shattered dreams, images of abounding, generous, exuberant beauty." End of quote, and end of prepared remarks. But I would like to play you a short piece, just because it seems to me somehow wrong for a composer to show up and do nothing but produce hot air. I like to represent myself by your having heard a little bit of my music, and I brought with me a tape of a short orchestra piece from 1988. I won't spend much time setting it up because I want there to be a little time for us to chat at the end, but let me just tell you the name of it and so on. It's a piece called Son et Lumière, that's in French, sound and light, but it's a phrase that the French use to describe these sort of tawdry light shows that they put on for tourists, usually at a castle or some sort of outdoor place where lights are projected and music is played, or sound effects are played. And the whole experience is a kind of play of colors and textures and the contrasts of those kinds. I tried to write a piece like that, a piece in which the interplay of textures and colors is, if not more important, at least as important as things like themes and rhythms and harmony and form, in which, in fact, the themes are coloristic and the form is made by coloristic contrast and so on. I don't think anybody ever quite succeeds at that, because it turns out you can't get by without notes, or shouldn't try. But that's the direction from which this piece comes. It belongs, I think, to an honorable intellectual and aesthetic tradition that includes people like Debussy, and to some extent people like Stravinsky and Ligeti and Messiaen, early 20th century and mid 20th century composers of that kind. It's a 9 or so minute piece, and I'm playing a tape by the Cincinnati Symphony Orchestra just from last season, with a very good Czech composer conductor called Libor Pešek. Which button do I push? Well, there's a red and a green. I'm going to go for the green, and we'll see what happens. staring at loudspeakers, though? I mean, is that unnatural experience? I wanted that piece. I set out to make that piece a kind of mainly entertaining experience. It turned out a little darker than it was meant to, I think, but it was meant to be a kind of showy, shiny, brilliant orchestral piece, which lies mainly on the surface in a way that a light, you know, that a Sony Lumiere does. But you noticed, and this is my own sanctioned programmatic interpretation of this piece, you noticed that towards the end the strings get fed up with this sort of superficial kind of music and attempt to launch a new piece of their own, something more serious and passionate and inward. They don't, I guess, quite succeed at that, but the attempt is a noble one, I think. Are there some questions? Comments?
What did you do for the 9 years?
What did I do for the 9 years? I removed a lot of parallel fifths. I mean, I've always taught. I went from Lawrence to Cornell University, where I've been now for 12 years. And so I've been teaching right through, and I suppose if I suddenly won the lottery, I would continue to teach, because there's something you get out of the interaction with students which you can't create on your own, which is very important to me. Can you all hear the question? Yeah, I don't know that I know the answer to that. I mentioned those three pieces because I have a little trouble with all of them. I think all three composers are brilliantly talented, and I actually like all three pieces, and I constantly worry while listening to them whether they're not aiming too low. So I don't know. So when you think about that question, I think you have to answer it for yourself, and you have to understand that I'm not arguing against popular music, which is an extremely important part of our culture none of us would like to live without, or against film music, for example, or even, I guess, against television music, although we're now dipping pretty far. But it is worth reminding ourselves what the functions of these various forms of music are, and not getting confused about what we're doing. Certainly the great art of the past has lots of popular elements, and it would be a mistake to try and exclude them now, I think. It would probably also be a mistake simply to capitulate to them and not try and make something out of them that's personal.
You mentioned earlier that a lot of orchestras around the country are going under because of the in-residence composers, the 20th century composers, that people were complaining about the 20th century type music. Why do you think that is? Do you feel that, is it because people don't think that 20th century music has as much aesthetic value as
No, it's a very complicated question. I wouldn't say that new music has actually sunk any orchestra all by itself. It's always economics that does that, or bad management. But and I would also say that in my sort of unscientific survey, I think people complain less than they used to. But there are still orchestras which simply get tired of the strain and cave into a few complainers. In Los Angeles, we have complaints. We also have people who write in and say, you're not playing enough new music. Go figure that out. But on balance, I think people have learned that it's a part of musical life, and that they don't have to like every piece that they hear. It's partly what you go to a concert with as expectations. If you think of music as merely consolation, you're going to be put off by everything you don't already know well enough that it doesn't actually require any active listening. And that will leave out most of the repertory, not only from the 20th century. I remember I was giving a pre-concert talk at Los Angeles once, and at the end of it I asked for questions, and a piece of mine was going to be on the program. And at the end of it I asked for questions, and a young man raised his hand, said, I come to the symphony to relax. Why are you doing this to us? And as nicely as I could, I said, sir, you're in the wrong place. The Eroica Symphony is not for relaxation either, you know. And it's a confusion about what we're doing. But you know that just sociologically, I mean, a lot of this orchestra office are people who, orchestra audience are people who worked all day and who want to go someplace and not think. And one can sympathize with that, but that's such a sort of demeaning attitude to the art that we love that we just can't permit people to believe that that's what it's for. Whether we're talking about Bach or Beethoven or Haydn or Stucky. That was a strange list. Or Haydn or... or Elliot Carter, let's say. Which composers have influenced me? Well, virtually all of them. But that list that I began to talk about that sort of includes Debussy, Ravel, and Stravinsky, and Ligeti, and Messiaen, and I didn't add, but I should, Lutoslawski. That's the line of composers that I feel attached to and from whom I've learned the most technically and sort of spiritually, aesthetically. Stravinsky is the most important composer, probably, to me. And you could, in fact, pick that out, probably, if you looked a little bit at his score.
Is there any composer that you find difficult or challenging, even at this stage, to listen to on a consistent basis?
Oh, many. Yeah. I mostly don't understand the music of Elliot Carter unless I work awfully hard at it. I do find with Carter, just as an example, that if I do my homework, it turns out Carter was right, usually. It was usually my fault that I didn't understand it, but it takes a lot of work. And there are certainly more difficult composers than Carter. That's not a reason to give up, though. And I mean, what I would say to audiences is, you know, all of life is a learning experience. Don't sort of turn that off as soon as you get into these plush red seats, you know, and the lights go down for a concert. We should be learning all the time and learning at whatever level we can. So when you encounter a new piece, you try as best you can, it's relaxed, and then learn what you can about it in one hearing. Then don't assume that you've learned everything there is to know about the piece and that the composer must have made a mistake. But like all the great art that we love, one has to get into it a layer at a time. There's something in a good performance of Carter, even for me on the first hearing, that makes me think, this is probably a real piece and there's something very exciting about it. I don't know what it is. And then it's my job to do listenings number 2 through 10.
Do you think new composers
Oh, the question is about the tendency of a lot of composers, and I'm one of them in a certain way, to use some elements of mostly pre-20th century tonality and old forms and so on. The piece I just played you is in a very kind of inferior type of sonata form. It has two themes, it has transitions, it has a development section, it has a coda. It's probably a measure of its success as a sonata that no one would have volunteered that information after hearing it. I'm absolutely uncomfortable with the notion that we have to sort of burn our bridges as we go and not only ignore the past but refuse to learn from it. I think that's simply willful and stupid. I mean, we have 7 centuries of a musical tradition. We ought to be learning from all of them and somehow putting to use what we can get from all of the past and present. And so, in principle, I'm very much in favor of composers who try to do that in their various ways. The results you have to judge for yourself, piece by piece and composer by composer. It can be a cop-out. I mean, extremely complex serial music can also be a cop-out. Depends on whether the composer hears what he's doing and believes in it. And a system or a return to somebody else's aesthetic, which is a substitute for your writing your own music, is dishonest, and the results eventually, I have to believe, sort of idealistically, the results of such dishonesty show through eventually.
Going back to the same question about influence, Is that something you're conscious of when you're composing? Do you think about, oh yeah, I'm taking this from Stravinsky, or is it more just, you just write what you write and that's an unconscious influence?
Both. I mean, the English horn solo, I knew exactly where that came from. If that's not from Petrushka, nothing ever was. And in fact, it was virtually deliberate, or one notices only 2 seconds later that that's where it comes from, you know, because I knew the program of the premiere, and it was my piece, then the complete Petrushka, and then after intermission, the Brahms violin concerto, as usual. and so there are sometimes deliberate, small and obviously audible effects, you know, which are conscious thefts. We were talking about this yesterday. Is it T.S. Eliot who said that talent borrows and genius steals? I'm working my way up. I'm still at the borrowing stage. But there's a kind of deeper influence which one sometimes doesn't notice until after the fact. And it's only in the last few years, really, that I've begun to understand exactly the ways and how deeply those ways go in which I'm so completely the child of early Stravinsky. Not the only one, it turns out, who's finding this out at this moment, but it took a while to realize for me and for many of my colleagues in this particular generation. The Schoenberg-Stravinsky wars are still going on in a certain way, but we now belong, most of us, to both sides. That's the good news. Well, it's been a pleasure for me, and I thank you for your attention and your hospitality.